Yay Networks.
13 has been my lucky number for a while. Like, it's always a sign of good things to come for me.
This is 13, a Taylor Swift fan podcast, breaking down every song, every Easter egg, every era, and every theory. Hosted by the biggest Swifties, Nick Adams, Anna Casiejos, Amy Nichols, and Lacey G.
Hey, thanks for joining us. It's time to break down our very first song on 13, a Taylor Swift fan podcast. We're doing Fearless today. My name's Nick Adams.
I'm Anna.
Amy.
I'm Lacey G.
And so we're breaking down one of the songs with just one of the most iconic intros. Anna, you've been a Swiftie for the longest.
Yes.
Take us back to when you first heard that.
Oh my God, 2008, 15 years old. And I'm glad that you tossed it over to me because I have a little surprise for you guys. As we start breaking down all of the albums, all of Fearless, her entire discography. So yes, I've been a Swiftie since 2008, since I first got her hard copy of Fearless over at Target, I remember. And I think it's really, really cool to revisit the Fearless era to, like, I've been feeling very nostalgic lately. And something that I absolutely loved about growing up with Taylor Swift is that she would always leave, like, little hidden messages, as we know. But, mm-hmm. like, I would go and, like, buy her album. And in her albums, I don't know if you guys knew this, but in her little album booklets, she would capitalize random letters. And they would spell out secret messages that had to do with what the song was about and things like that. And I would go to Target, buy the booklet, grab a pen, circle the letters and things like that. So I actually brought you guys gifts.
What? Gifts? Wow, how like Taylor. Taylor's good at giving gifts too, guys.
Mm-hmm.
Just like Anna is.
Gifts. I know, this is very Taylor of me.
Wow. They're in bags with paper. Now, hold on. The bags are three different color bags.
What does it mean?
Well, but there's only two different color tissue papers.
Mm-hmm. Read into it, if you will.
So she was... There's the rumor she has three albums with Folklore, Evermore, Woodvale. Yeah. Does this have to do with the third album?
Maybe. No, it doesn't. I tried to find the most little Fearless era bags I could find. They have like gold sparkles on them. Feel free to go ahead and open it.
In a certain order? Are they all the
They're
same?
They're all the same. Okay. Sorry, spoiler.
Before
all the same
I open mine and I have to be nice to you again, can I just point out the fact that Anna thinks that she's better than all of us because she's been a super Swiftie sleuth for a very long time? Because that's what I got from that statement.
Oh, it's a physical copy of Taylor Swift's Fearless Taylor's version.
Yes! Thank you!
It's the Target exclusive.
Yes, it is the physical copy. I own all of Taylor's CDs, physical copies. I don't know about you guys. I still have a CD player in my car. So if like my aux cord ever works, I have her entire discography up for grabs. Like I have all of her CDs. And I think I just wanted to welcome you guys into the Fearless era for your first time, which I think is very cool.
That's very sweet of you.
If you wanted to go through and look at the little album booklet. And I think something really cool, not to get emo. I know I'm going to cry every episode of this podcast.
I mean, it's only like 2 minutes in.
Because... Growing up, I obviously loved Taylor, but I never had like that one friend that I could be like, oh my God, did you see this? Or did you listen to this? Or did you go to this? And all like that. And now I have you guys.
Aww.
And I go full Swiftie every single time. Don't even hold back. And so I'm very excited for this podcast. I'm excited for you guys to have the CDs that Taylor owns, Taylor's version.
Anna, that is so sweet.
Nice.
I know. Thank you.
I know.
I have to say, I think mine might be the most special, guys. Because mine's cracked on the...
Is it really?
The case is cracked a little bit.
No, stop.
It is. Maybe your dog stepped on it, but that makes it more special. It's personality.
It's the inside that counts.
And you know what? I did debate going to get this because it has a poster in it, right?
Yes.
I did debate going to get it, and I was like, I was kind of lazy that day, so I just downloaded it on iTunes.
Well, I'm glad you didn't because I got it for you.
That is so sweet. Thank you, Anna, because I have a confession. I have not listened to her Fearless album, and I was waiting to go get a physical copy so I could listen to it because I wanted to support her. So thank you. That is
so
sweet.
You're welcome.
So
now you can listen to it in the car.
I love it. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Well, let's get down to business today, ladies. Today, we're breaking down... So Fearless is the first track on her second album, that's also called Fearless, and was released back in 2008. If you don't know why she's re-recording Fearless and all her other music, we have a podcast breaking all of this down. If you have, what do we think, 7 hours to listen to it, you can go back and listen to it. It's the podcast that was right before this. So I was reading about why people think that she dropped Fearless first, and we kind of covered this a little bit in the last one. And so one theory is that Fearless turns 13 this year.
Yes, love that.
13's, of course, her favorite number. So she announced the release of Fearless Taylor's version on February 11th, 12 plus 11 equals 13. She dropped Fearless Taylor's version on April 9th, 4 plus 9 is 13. The album has 26 tracks. 13 plus 13 is 26.
Love her. Love it.
Yes.
It's just brilliant the way that her mind works.
Do you think she's ever in the car and she's like driving and she sees the billboard and she sees the number, you know, 1 and 3 amongst 100 letters on a billboard, and she starts talking and someone in the car is like, I get it. We get it, Taylor.
Well, she had said
13 was on the billboard a mile back.
She had said like a couple years ago, like, you know, way back when, that on like if there was like an award show one day and she naturally saw the number 13, she felt like she would win. But if she didn't, she thought it was bad luck. It's amazing. The number follows her everywhere. She's incredible.
It's completely off topic. Does anyone have a favorite number? Mine's 33.
I think mine's 3. I think that's yours too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, mine's 3. 11-11! I'm super annoying. I am that annoying number person because I just like reputation. I do like reputation, but I like repetitiveness. So I love the number 11-11, and I have beat everybody down at work having my 11-11 celebrations every day.
Taylor wrote the song Fearless when she was traveling to promote her debut album. She was on tour, so she wrote it in 2006. She wrote this song with two ladies named Liz Rose and Hillary Lindsay. You don't know really who they are, but you know a lot of songs that they've written. So Taylor wrote White Horse with Liz Rose. Mm. She wrote You Belong With Me, Tell Me Why on this album with Liz Rose. On her debut album, she wrote a lot with Liz Rose. Tim McGraw, Picture to Burn, Teardrops My Guitar, Cold as You, Ties Together with a Smile, Stay Beautiful, Mary Song. On Red, she wrote All Too Well.
Ooh.
With Liz. Hillary Lindsay, another songwriter on this song. I think this is the only song she wrote with Taylor, but she's written for a ton of other artists. Faith Hill, Martina McBride, Shakira, Lady Antebellum, Sarah Evans, Carrie Underwood, Kelly Pickler, Bon Jovi, Taylor Swift. Lady Gaga, Tim McGraw, and Luke Bryan. Pretty cool.
Well, I want to hear your Luke Bryan.
Hey, y'all, this is Luke Bryan. I don't know if that really sounds like Luke Bryan, but someone told me it did once.
So I think what made the song Fearless so easily successful and a great title track for the album is that it so effortlessly describes what it feels like to be a young teenage girl with an idea of love. You know, like you've never really been in a serious relationship. This is what she thinks love is going to feel like and what it's going to be like. And in my notes I wrote, in 2008, I heard the song and it shaped me as a person. In 2021, I heard the song and it shaped me as a person.
Wow, how creative.
I know. And something cool that I like about the clip that you played, you know, from the chorus is I don't know why, but with you, I dance in a storm in my best dress, fearless. I think that idea is really, really perfectly reflected in the Delicate music video where she's literally dancing in a storm in her best dress.
Yeah.
Fearless. And when I first watched the Delicate music video, I was like, ugh, fearless. Also, do you guys want to hear about the hidden message in Fearless? So in the physical copies, like the ones that I just gave you, in the original ones, like I said, she would capitalize random letters in the lyrics and they'd always spell out a sentence and it gave a little bit of backstory to each song. And then she was doing that up until Reputation. That's when she kind of stopped doing that. And for some reason, she would always capitalize random letters, except for in 1989, she did the opposite and it was lowercase letters that spelled out hidden messages. So the hidden message in Fearless, the song, says, I loved you before I met you.
Who's that about?
Well, I think she wrote this song before ever being in a relationship.
Yeah.
So it was just the idea, that sweet vulnerability.
Right. So I think that makes sense.
Yeah.
So I've heard this song before, but never really paid much attention to it. I got into Taylor a couple years ago, a handful of years ago, but still I didn't start back from the very beginning and just take it all in. That's why now I'm appreciating this time that I'm getting to learn everything and introduce myself to music that I haven't heard before. Whenever I was listening to this song, there was one lyric that got me from the get-go. I wanna ask you to dance right there in the middle of the parking lot. Have you ever danced in a parking lot before? Has anybody?
A parking light?
A parking lot?
Light?
A parking, what?
Well, like the light, okay. I
like when it's dark and there's...
Right, there's a light, like the pole. I haven't done
you
it
You danced
personally.
On the pole of the parking lot?
I didn't, but we would all like turn our lights, like park towards the pole of the parking lot light, and they would dance on
as a teenager. So, yes, I guess.
You went to a Christian school, Amy Nichols. Unbelievable.
I've only danced in parking lots in my best dress, Fearless.
Mm. See, because that sounds so romanticized to me about dancing in your best dress, like dancing in the rain and that kind of stuff. Mm. But whenever she's talking about just dancing in the parking lot, that just reminds me of like good times late at night, probably leaving a bar. I know this is what she was thinking because she was so young then, but I've had some good parking lot parties before where you're still having the good time outside, but then also I was with my girlfriend one time and she had just gotten really good news and we're dancing out in the street and I go to dip her and she was like really hesitant and wouldn't let me dip her. And I said, you don't trust me? I got you. And then she let me dip her and then I dropped her on the ground and somebody saw me and I felt so stupid. But that was a parking lot party that kind of blew up in my face. I didn't mean to, but that was a really bad let me preface this with I've got you and then just drop you.
I got to say, parking lot party. That could be Luke Bryan's next number one hit single. Parking Lot Party. That is a great country song.
It is. Featuring Taylor Swift.
Sure.
This line really stuck out to me.
You're just so cool. Run your hands through your hair.
I just thought that that was a brilliant line from her. Mm-hmm. Because we've all been there whenever somebody's just playing with themselves. And it's like, why are you looking so cute over there?
Yeah.
And it's like, I'm not doing anything. But yeah, I really like that line. Absentmindedly making me want you.
Yeah, absolutely.
What does being fearless mean to you guys? What is fearless?
I feel like because of this album and because of Taylor Swift, I associate the word fearless with just like really being happy, which at the end of the day, it's a really sad album. But I don't know, like maybe it's because the song is upbeat, like drive me head first, fear. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of like, yeah, like you're just going to dive into something without knowing it. You're going to dive into love. You're going to dive into a relationship. You're just going to see how it goes.
Mm-hmm. Right. It means that you're not bulletproof, but you're going to do it anyways.
Sure. Sure.
Well, and because she was an awkward teenager whenever she wrote this. So for her, being fearless was more to be able to go out in public and take on the world. Mm-hmm. And I'm ready to have a boyfriend and I'm ready to move on to the next stage of my life.
Yeah.
And accepting of it.
Well, guys, Amy gets a point. Because she's the closest to what Taylor actually is quoted as saying. Taylor said in an interview that fearless doesn't mean you're completely unafraid, and it doesn't mean that you're bulletproof. It means that you have a lot of fears, but you jump anyways. And that's what influenced her to write this song and then to name it, the whole album, Fearless.
Yeah, you might think I'm bulletproof, but I'm not. Mm-hmm. Also, something with the whole re-recorded Taylor's versions. So this is obviously the first track, and I know a lot of people like you, Nick, when Fearless, Taylor's version was first released, you went straight to the bonus song.
I did, yeah.
I went in order. I had to listen to it again the way I listened to it back in 2008. Like, I just had to. And, you know, with Fearless, when she first started, her voice is deeper, I, like, got emotional, surprised, totally shocked. It's interesting to think about the differences between the original version and Taylor's version, because she wants it to basically sound identical to the point where we as fans don't feel the need to go listen to the original version. And going through the entire album, and I'll kind of point this out with every song, but there's little background vocals that really stand out to me, because I was thinking, like, is she going to do those ooh ahs in the background? Is she going to do the giggle and Hey Steven? Like, all of these little tiny things I was, like, anticipating. And then when she does it, I was so over the moon. And so there's a specific part that I pulled clips up to compare the original to Taylor's version, which is when she just says, ooh, yeah.
So that was the original.
That was the original, and here's the Taylor's version.
Oh, yeah. I can hear the difference in the maturity.
When you hear back to back, right?
Yeah.
I wasn't sure if it was just in my head because I wanted to hear that, the maturity in her voice, or if I was actually hearing that. And I could almost tell, like, a little less of a twang. I know
went
line by line trying to get it exactly the same, but a little bit better. So the maturity in her voice, she practiced so hard getting her voice to be better.
Yeah, her voice is definitely, like you say, matured. It's just different sounding. And all of these songs take on a new meaning now that she's in her 30s singing about young love.
Yeah.
Because now it's much more of a looking back to when I was young, and we'll definitely see it when we do 15 next.
Yeah.
That was what really stuck out to me on 15, was like, oh, it's a completely different story now.
Mm-hmm.
It takes on a different meaning. Love it.
A lot of the songs do. And something else, and I found like a lyrical parallel in Fearless, because we know Taylor loves connecting all of her music. And the very first line of the song Fearless is this.
There's something about the way the street looks when it's just rained. There's
there's a glow off the pavement. You walk me to the car.
And then just a few weeks ago, we were gifted with the song You All Over Me, which is from The Vault, which was supposed to be on Fearless. And this is a line from that song.
Once the last drop of rain has dried off the pavement.
And I think that's just like such a direct continuation of like a story in an album that when I first heard You All Over Me, I was like, release them all, Taylor. Give me all of The Vault songs, please. And I just think that was really cool. And I wanted to share that.
Would anyone like to hear stats on how this song performed?
Absolutely.
I'm a nerd and I like hearing, you know, was this, we love it.
Yeah.
Did anyone else love it?
Let's hear it.
So this song, it debuted at number 9, and that's as high as it got, at number 9 on the Billboard Hot 100. And whenever we say Billboard or the charts or Hot 100, that's just the chart that combines all songs, all genres. So if you're number 1 in the country, you're number 1 in the Hot 100. She got to number 9. That's the highest it went. It was certified platinum. And it was the first single to be certified gold before it was even released as a single, which is interesting. So, because people just kept buying it before her record label even put it out. Because mm-hmm. it had been out for a while. And it was like the last single, I think, that they put out for the album. This album, Fearless, that we're doing right now, it won Album of the Year at the Grammys, which is incredible. Yay. and that, her winning Album of the Year for Fearless, came, did you guys know that it came 4 months after the Kanye incident?
Really?
Yes. Four months later, he stormed the stage. It was like September or something, August, September at the MTV Movie Awards. A few months later, in like January or February, she wins Album of the Year. So who did Taylor beat for Album of the Year for this album, Fearless? She beat Lady Gaga's The Fame, Beyonce's I Am Sasha Fierce, an album from Dave Matthews Band that I had never heard of called Big Whiskey and Gru Grunk King, and the Black Eyed Peas, The End. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
That is interesting.
Good job, Taylor.
And was she, correct me, I think I could be wrong, I'm just kind of speaking here, but she was the youngest to win Album of the Year, right? Up until Billie Eilish?
So, yeah.
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
Okay, do we want to hear what Taylor had to say about her re-recordings and what some fans are saying?
Yes.
Yes, good. I'm glad that you said that because I was going to go through it anyway. So here's what Taylor had said about the re-recording. She said, "We really did go in and try to create the same but better version. We kept all the parts that I initially dreamed up for these songs, but if there was any way we could improve upon the song quality, we did. We just kind of took all the knowledge that we've acquired over the decades of playing this music and applied that to it. I did go in line by line and listen to every single vocal and think, you know, what are my intentions here? If I could improve upon it, I did." So she really wanted to try to keep it as genuine as possible, but you can't help but notice the differences.
Right.
So I went to what I consider the Taylor Bible. She doesn't subscribe to this necessarily, but if I want all of my Taylor information, I go to two places. I go to TikTok and I go to Reddit. Yeah. So this is from Reddit. I wanted to see what all the fans were saying, and someone said, "Everything sounds so close to the original, just with cleaner production. I appreciate that she didn't try to fake a country accent. The song is still super country without the heavy twang. I also appreciate the tiny changes she made to the vocals and drawing out some of the syllables." Someone else said, "Anyone else having a hard time not singing along so you can hear the new versions?"
Right.
I thought that was genius because you're trying to listen so hard.
I was in the car listening to The Weeknd, and my husband, Josh, had the audacity to turn it down after the third time we listened to the same song. I was like, I'm trying to pick out the differences.
Did you divorce him?
No.
Who was driving?
He was.
Okay, I was going to say, because you could have driven that car off the road, mister.
He should have.
I can't believe you would tolerate that.
It's funny because I was in the car also listening with my boyfriend, and I was listening for like the difference in the ooh yeahs and the ha-has and stuff. And I would like turn up the volume when it like came on, and I turned to Ryan and be like, "Did you hear the difference?" He's like, "I don't know the original." Like, here I was being like, "Did you hear it? Did you hear
it?
You heard it, right?" But it's been so fun. Something fun about the song Fearless is every time she performed it on the Fearless tour, she would wear this sparkly silver dress with black boots, and she would perform it with an acoustic guitar. And it just became this very iconic look for the song Fearless. And in the lyric video for Taylor's version, if you go and watch it, there's a photo of her in that sparkly silver dress with the black boots and the acoustic guitar and her curly, curly hair in the wind. And I just think it's really cool how with all the lyric videos for Taylor's version, she has like an image or something that associates with the original. Mm-hmm. And I just think that's really, really cool.
That is cool.
And also something to point out about Fearless, the album, is the album cover, right? Because in the original, she has like her head turned and her curls are like wide up in the air, and I've personally tried to recreate that many a time. I don't know how she did it because it looks amazing. And then in the new cover, she has her head turned the other way and her hair is up in the air, kind of similar, But this time it looks like she's wearing Romeo's shirt from the Love Story music video. And a lot of fans take that to kind of mean like she is her own Prince Charming. Mm-hmm. Now that she owns everything and this is a re-recorded, this is Taylor's version. She doesn't need no man. She don't need mm-hmm. anybody. She's got her. And mm-hmm. I think that's really cool.
I probably could have done research on this, but I didn't. I know when she did the photo shoots for Folklore and Forevermore, it was just her and a photographer. Mm-hmm. She didn't want a lot of people because of COVID. And like she did her own makeup and everything like that. I wonder if she did that with this cover. You know what I mean? I wonder if she recreated it with like a teeny tiny crew.
I would hope so.
I would assume.
I would assume she would.
But I don't know.
That's it for this episode of 13, a Taylor Swift fan podcast. What did we miss? I'm sure there's an Easter egg, a fan theory that we didn't get right or that we missed. Let us know. All the ways to contact us are in the description of this podcast. And you're going to want to join us because on our very next episode, we're talking all about 15.
Thanks for listening to 13, a Taylor Swift fan podcast. Subscribe for free and leave a positive review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or Google Podcasts.